Hey, you want to go for a ride?
No, thanks.
No, thanks. What does that mean?
I don't want to go.
Go where?
For a ride.
Yes, that's a human ear, all right.
I don't know if you're a detective or a pervert.
I like to sing Blue Velvet.
Do you want to do bad things? Anything. Anything.
Started with Bobby Vinton's song, Blue Velvet, which came out in 1964, but I started getting these ideas from the song of a mystery that would take place in a small city in quiet neighborhoods. Then I had this desire to sneak into a girl's room and watch her throughout a night, and possibly while watching I'd see a clue to a mystery. And then I got this idea for finding an ear in a field, and this ear would be an opening into another world. And then I got a lot of other ideas like this, but fragments that finally hooked themselves together and formed enough of a story so that I could add in the missing pieces. But this took a long time. I've written four drafts of the script over several years, before I finally got it together to film it.
David and I met for Dune, and we met, I can tell you exactly where it was. It was at Universal City, or at the Universal Studios. And he was working with Rafaela De Laurentiis at the time to try and bring this monster book to screen, Frank Herbert's Dune. And he was just coming back from his daily lunch jaunt to Bob's Big Boy, which is what he was doing in those days. And I was sitting in the office waiting, and he came walking in, and he was wearing the classic Lynch uniform, which is a khaki pant, white shirt, black coat, jacket, like sport coat, and black shoes with sort of tasseled brunette sort of hair sort of going every which way. I really knew nothing about the man. I knew that he had done Eraserhead, which I promptly went out to see, before I went for the meeting, which just confused me even more. I didn't know what to expect when I met David. And he was so friendly and so available. Which really took me back a little bit.
Because Dune was not such a big success, and things went badly, Dino and I were ready to part company. But then he came back and said, what is this Blue Velvet, And I said, Dino, you're so crazy. I said, you know about this thing. I told you about it before. But he says, I must read again. And I said, well, you can read the first half of it, because I like the first half of it. And he read it, and he really liked it. And I said, let me fix the second half, and then, we'll do it. And that's how it started.
I think he probably had me in mind for Jeffrey the moment that he met me.
I think he's a very, fine actor, number one. And I like him because, for like Jeffrey, he's got a kind of an innocent quality. He's curious. He's innocent, but he can traverse from one world to another.
He gave me the script to look at, and you got to remember that I mean, Dune was like the first screenplay that I'd ever read, and Blue Velvet was basically the second screenplay that I'd ever read. So I still really didn't know what to make of it, but I thought it was incredibly charged, very erotic. I thought frightening, kind of amazing, like in an overpowering way, and frightened me and also sort of filled me with this desire to go into that world. We were meant to start Blue Velvet in January of 85, And I remember getting the call. It was in my dad's office in Yakima, Washington, in fact. I got a call from David, and he said they're not going to do the movie.
Dino always believed in David and always believed in the movie, but couldn't spend the $10 million that was part of an original budget.
And finally, in August of 85, Dino, according to David, called him up and said, David, I have a crazy idea.
He said, if I cut my salary and cut the budget for Blue Velvet, I could have total artistic control.
During the negotiations and the time, David said, but Dino, I have to have final cut of this movie. And Dino said, I can't give you final cut of this movie. I can't put it in the contract. Then every other director will want final cut of their movies, and I can't do that. But I'll shake your hand, and you have my word. And Dino never goes back on his word. And David Lynch had final cut of his movie. David always wanted Isabella Rossellini, Dennis Hopper, Kyle MacLachlan, and Laura Dern. And they read the script, and to work with David Lynch, they all agreed to do it and got paid literally nothing. I mean, a little bit above scale, but literally nothing to do it because they believed in it or understood it or wanted to do it.
Yes? What is it?
Pest control. You gotta do your apartment.
That stuff stinks.
Well, Isabella is, fantastic. I feel extremely lucky to have, found her for Dorothy, because in my mind now that she's the only possible Dorothy.
I was having dinner with a friend of mine in a restaurant here in New York, and David was having dinner with a friend of his in the same restaurant. And our friends knew each other, so they introduced each other, and so my friend Camilla and I sat at David's table. David started to talk about being in New York to do some casting, and he wanted Helen Mirren for Dorothy Valance, and I had just finished a film with Helen Mirren. And so he said, oh, can you talk to her about playing this part? I really want her to play this part, but I didn't know Helen that well, so I said, I don't know that I can do that. And so we talked a little bit, I knew he was there casting, and then I don't know what we talked about, chit-chatting. And then the next day, or 2 days after, there was a note from David saying, after dinner, I thought that maybe you'd like to read the script and you would like to test for the role.
The things that struck me about her in the beginning was I wanted Dorothy to be beautiful, but have a mysterious quality, and a vulnerable quality within the mystery.
Well, I was a model. I didn't really have an acting career. I had done one film in America prior to Blue Velvet, which was called White Nights, a film about dancing where I had a secondary role. It was really only White Nights, my first American film, that I thought I was going to try to be an actress. So Blue Velvet was my second experience as an actress.
That'd be sweet. Mommy loves you.
When I read the script, I thought it was very original. I thought it was very powerful. I loved Dorothy Valance, and I knew that it was going to be a role that was difficult to play. And so I asked David Lynch if we could do a really thorough test, not a 10 minutes, and if I could also test with Kyle MacLachlan, who was cast as the lead. We went, Kyle and I, and we played all the scenes. We improvised. I mean, some of it I knew the dialogue, some of it I didn't remember the dialogue. But at least I could show David what was my interpretation of Dorothy Valance and if it agreed with it.
In the beginning, it's sort of all over the place. The early rehearsals are very rough, and they're sort of frightening because you wonder if it's ever going to come down to fitting what you have in your mind.
I was 18. I don't know that David had ever seen me in a movie.
How did you know?
We both remember I was sitting on the floor waiting for him to come in, and he walked out and he was like, I gotta take a pee, and disappeared. That was the first thing he ever said to me. And then we started talking about meditation, because I was a meditator too, and we talked for an hour about meditation and I don't know, everything from like astrology to grafting peach trees with pear trees. And it was one of those conversations, and we were a match made in heaven, I think, as anybody David works with. He didn't ask me to read. He said he knew I was perfect, which all these directors ask you to read, and he said, I don't know, I don't believe in reading. You know the person's right or you don't. It has nothing to do with, you know, if they're reading the part, which is kind of wonderful, you know, and amazing. But he said he wanted me to do it, but he wanted to make sure that Kyle MacLachlan, who was going to play Jeffrey, and I kind of could hit it off, and it felt right to him to see us together. So he asked me to meet them at Bob's Big Boy. And the three of us had had our Bob's Big Boy meeting. And the rest is history.
Let's fuck! I'll fuck anything that moves!
Dennis has got a reputation. You know, Dennis used to take a lot of drugs and drink a lot of, you know, alcohol.
Well, I just came out of rehab for drugs and alcohol. So I didn't really have a career. I was trying to get started again. So the first three films that I made after I got out was Blue Velvet, Hoosiers, and River's Edge, and I made them all back to back. I was advised by my agency not to do the part because it was not a redeemable character, and I said, I realize that, but it's being directed by David Lynch, and I think David Lynch is a very important director, and I think everybody in Hollywood will see this film, and I want to do the part. I don't know what David's knowledge of my prior work was. I don't know how I got the part. I know I really wanted the part badly. I'd never talked to David on the telephone, except the one time when I called him after I got the part. So I don't know what the process was of how I got it, really.
Dennis truly understood Frank.
I called him when I heard that I got the part, and he was having lunch with Isabella Rossellini and Kyle MacLachlan and Laura Dern. And I told him that I was Frank Booth. He said, well, that's great, that's terrific, and we'll have a really good shoot, and so on and so on. He went back to the table at lunch, and he said, I just talked to Dennis Hopper, and he told me that he was Frank Booth, and it's great for the picture, but I don't know how we'll ever have lunch with him.
It's Daddy, you shithead. Where's my bourbon?
I came into films through painting, and I came in really knowing nothing about film. I mean, I saw films, but I saw films not from a movie buff, you know, point of view. But I wanted to be a painter.
David Lynch studied art. David Lynch came out of Philadelphia, out of the university there, out of art school, and is a painter. So I think it's a natural assumption to think that that he deals with surrealism in his own way. I mean, it's certainly, it's not Salvador Dali, but it's what I call American surrealism. From the fire engine to the picket fence with the roses on it, to the man having the heart attack with the dog and the water and spraying the water and the insects under the soil and the very phony robin with the, you know, the robins have come back. Yeah, this mechanical. I mean, it's surrealism to me, American surrealism.
Only in Buñuel film I saw is Chien Andalou. You know, that was with Dali. But you know, many people say that there's similarities. I went to Salzburg to study with Kakashka. I was going to go to school there, and I'm planning to stay for 3 years, but it was all so beautiful and so clean that I became very worried because I didn't feel like it was giving me something, you know, for painting. I went back and went almost immediately to Philadelphia, and Philadelphia was exactly what I needed. It was almost the opposite of Salzburg. It was one of the worst cities in the world, but it was thrilling, you know, sort of to me. It opened up some little doors and made it all start happening.
I met David Lynch at the American Film Institute. One of the instructors, one of my mentors there, Tony Valani, introduced us and said, you know, Fred, here's a filmmaker that I think you're gonna like. He's kind of one of a kind, and you know, I think you'll get along with him. And he introduced me, and we got to work on Eraserhead together. David is an artist in many senses. He paints and he draws, and they're very beautiful drawings, paintings. He loves sound, he loves music. You know, he does that as well. And he makes, you know, these brilliant films. So on all those levels, you know, I enjoyed watching his work, and I enjoyed watching the art progress.
Lynch is so identifiable in how he creates and ties things together in the world and the people. And yes, it is odd, and yes, it is strange, and yet it has a certain form and a certain logic to it.
He definitely wants to create a world where you never know where you are, because that's the world he exists in, and it's the world we all exist in.
He creates out of a really interesting place and is consistent and has a vision that's purely his. I mean, you can tell his movies from anybody else's. Even if you looked at Elephant Man and some of the Strader films, that you can still see it's him.
He is, I think, in the true sense of the word, a visionary. And he follows his own vision, and it is unique, and it belongs to him. And I think his painting, as well as his writing and his filmmaking, all come from that same source.
And I think it's like an unconscious or a subconscious trust. I mean, that's what David has. He trusts his subconscious and his unconscious. So while everyone else around him is going, I don't know, David's like, he may think, I don't know either, but at least he's knowing, you know what, this came from me. I'm going to trust that it's right.
It's a strange world, isn't it?
Yeah.
He finds interest sometimes in things that most of us, you know, think are fairly commonplace.
David would come in on a Monday morning with Polaroids that he took with his son, and they would go to the grocery store and get a whole chicken and take a Polaroid of the chicken, and then they'd cut up the chicken and move the parts around so the wing was where the leg and the leg was where the wing and the head was up the ass and whatever, and he'd take all these Polaroids and to show, you know, with his kid, and he's look at all these Polaroids.
You can be shooting the inside of a dead cow in close-up, and if you didn't know it was the inside of a dead cow, and you enlarge the photo and put it in a room, people could say this is just so beautiful.
David Lynch has this mind that goes into the darkest depths of civilization in his mind, but yet on the outside, as a person, he's a Jimmy Stewart.
He is a true Eagle Scout.
I'm not so much of an intellectual, but I am more of an intuitive sort of person.
David is not very verbal, or when he talks, he might say things very funny, but he's very expressive, so you always know what he likes, what he doesn't like. He exudes what he thinks rather than articulate what he thinks.
I came into film without having to, you know, really speak or ever articulate certain feelings in words. So I like thinking somewhere beneath the surface.
His film is much darker to me than David is in person. David in person seems a much more serene, happy, adjusted person that he is in film. A lot of people think of him as extremely eccentric or dangerous, or sometimes people had asked me, does he take drugs? Does he have hallucinations? And he said David is a very, very sweet, calm, and happy, born happy. I think he's a very happy person. I've never met anybody who's so serene and luminous as he is.
I like things that are different. And I like distortions because I see so many distortions either inside of people or on the surface. I see, you know, this kind of confusion and darkness and distortions, and it's sort of, you know, fascinating to me.
We decided to film the movie in Wilmington because that's where the studio was, and we knew that we could do it for the price, and we hired all local people and local actors, other than the people we brought in from the outside. And it so happened that Lumberton was the name of a town in North Carolina. It's about an hour and a half or 2 hours outside of Wilmington. And I didn't realize that it was a real town. And I had said to David, where did you get the name of Lumberton? Well, he kind of said that he made it up, and he kind of said that he didn't make it up until we find out that it was the name of a real town.
Lumberton is a great name because it makes a picture in your mind.
I called the Chamber of Commerce to tell them, to inform them and the mayor's office that we were making this movie and we were calling our town Lumberton, which was a fictitious name, nothing to do with their town, and did we have the right to use their name.
The town had some very old neighborhoods and they didn't look southern because it's in the south. And so I was very happy because in my mind this town is a little bit more northern. The atmosphere and the mood was so good, and the sidewalks were so beautiful. And I realized, I didn't know it before, but shooting on location is fantastic because when you go into someone's real house, you can't believe it, what they've got in these houses. And it gives you so many ideas.
We all felt like we were sort of castaways in this little studio in Wilmington, North Carolina, which suited us just fine. I know David was never happier. Dune, I think, was such a difficult slog, really, as it got going. He was down in Mexico for like a year and a half, you know, trying to manage this lumbering beast, you know, of a gigantic film. And it just, I think it really, really worked, you know, worked on him. And Blue Velvet was just really streamlined and perfect. And David was right back in his element. And I think it sort of, it reinvigorated him and reminded him of what it is that he loves to do, you know, and why he loves filmmaking so much is because of this.
Blue Velvet is a whole new ball game. I'm back into a place where I feel so good about film and about a way of working.
The challenging part of the movie is the crew asking questions and not having an answer because David hadn't told us yet.
We had a little budget, and sometimes there were economical limitation, or running late, or shooting long, long hours, sometimes 18, 19 hours per day.
Come closer.
It was nerve-wracking, really, really was, for any number of reasons. I mean, first of all, it's, you know, I'm standing there with my shorts off, you know, and I'm like, camera crews around, and Isabella Rossellini is right in front of me with a knife. I mean, that's not enough to sort of, you know, make you wake up in the morning of that scene with a few butterflies. You know what is?
Hello, baby.
Shut up! It's Daddy, you shithead. Where's my bourbon?
I didn't know Dennis, and it was his first film after a long, long time of healing from his drug abuse. And I was obviously a bit frightened of him. I had asked if I could have breakfast with him because the first scene that I shot with Dennis was the scene of him doing this sort of ritualistic rape. And I remember going to breakfast with him. I joined him at the hotel where it was, and he seemed very bored. Said, what do you want? You want to know me? Here I am, you know. So I said, we're going to do this one. But he was right, because then on the set, Dennis was very, I remember that, you know, I had to open my legs, and he kind of kneels in front of me.
Mommy.
Mommy loves you.
Baby wants to fuck.
She was naked, and I wasn't told. I assumed that David, that they knew, but I didn't know.
Now show it to me.
I tried to do the scene with underwear, but we couldn't, because in a certain angle you would see the underwear. So we had, in one angle, we had to take the underwear off. Not that you would see it with the camera, but you would see the strap. I forgot what it was. And that embarrassed me. To be in front of, I mean, Dennis was going to be the only person who was going to see my vagina from up close like this, but still it was embarrassing because I didn't know him at all.
That was the first day. I'd never met Isabella, and suddenly she's nude in front of me.
So I said, I'm sorry to do this. It really, it's hard. And he said, ah, I've seen it before. And in his rude way, he made me very comfortable. I said, oh, that's right. You've seen it all. I don't worry about you.
That was certainly an act of faith on her part and David's part to, like, to expose themselves that way.
There was a lot of laughing, funny enough. People don't probably realize that, but it was a lot of laughing that would go on, probably as a counterpoint to what you were seeing on film.
I remember David laughing so hard at that scene, laughing so hard. I remember stopping the scene once, and I said, David, what is there to laugh? This is a rape. What is there to laugh? And he said, I don't know, it just makes me laugh. And then years later, maybe 15 years after, the film was on television, and I looked at the film and just remember David laughing. It made me laugh, belly laugh like David, because I still don't understand what made him laugh.
David was wonderful. He was like a Boy Scout leader. You know, he'd say, peachy keen, solid gold, let's do one more. He would say, now, when you say that word, and I said, well, that word's fuck, David. He says, yes, I know, but when you say that word,
get ready to fuck, you fuckers, fucker, you fucker. Don't you fucking look at me.
A great director to me is somebody who steps back and allows the actors to do their thing. And David is very much in that school of understanding that. You fix something when it's not working, you know? And you encourage people to go with what's working. And that's, and a lot of that is not an intellectual dialogue and this is your character and you should do this and that. It's not that. It's just trust.
He will often direct with a word or a phrase. And it's so amazing because you just immediately know what he's talking about. A lot of times he'd say, you know, give it a little more mystery or give it a little more wind. And I remember for that entrance, you know, he was like, it needs to feel like a wind. Like, you know, you just kind of come in like a wind. And he had the music playing and it was a slightly breezy night. He played Shostakovich over like loudspeakers for us on the street because he felt that we needed to walk to the music and the mood should feel like that piece of music. So I mean, it's so exciting. You know, he's so impassioned and he takes such time and he's so meticulous.
With David, I always felt I could be completely free because later on, I can always rediscuss or at that moment say, this disturbs me and maybe this just embarrasses me. You know, just as a human being, I'm too embarrassed to be shown naked like this.
Feel me.
Sometimes there were some close-ups where I remember David was very, very close to me, very, very close to the camera, and I almost felt he directed me like an orchestra director would direct live for a violinist player. We say, bring that up. No, bring it down. Now, you know, though he didn't talk to me, I could sense his presence, where if I would go very languid, he had encouraged me to go in that direction. And then as I was just going too far, I would feel his body tense, and so I would stop a little bit and go sad, and maybe he didn't like me to go sad, so I could also sense his presence. I thought maybe that's the way it works in an orchestra, with the orchestra director not only giving the timing, but also giving the feeling right then and there, so that every concert, even if it is the same piece of music, might be different. And sometimes David directed like that when he could, especially on close-up, because he could come very close to us.
Oftentimes we would do a take and he would stop. And he'd sort of walk in from behind the camera, he'd sort of clasp his hands like this and furrow his brow. And I'd be there and I'd be sort of standing there and I'd sort of, you know, mimic him sort of probably unconsciously. And we'd be just kind of standing there thinking and thinking, nothing would be said, just sort of thinking back. And I'd sort of, he'd say, okay, let's try it again. And I'd be like, okay, yeah, good. And it was like this sort of eerie, non-spoken, and yet so much communicated, and yet I couldn't even tell you what it was, really. But we go back and we do it again.
The similarities between Jeffrey and David, I think, are there.
They snow kid lived there, had the biggest tongue in the world.
Doesn't Kyle look like David? And doesn't David look like Kyle?
Well, I would imagine that Jeffrey was always a little eccentric growing up, and probably a loner, I think. And for whatever reason, this was his uniform, this was his outfit he felt comfortable in. And he doesn't veer away from it much. Maybe there's a change of tie. I think that was the extent of it. The story catches him on the cusp of something, sort of that transition from boyhood to manhood, sort of. He sort of, not willingly all the time, but he does go through the journey, and then once he gets close, it's like that image of, you know, you're sort of being, you're grabbed by fate, whatever, and pulled along. You've sort of gone too far, particularly when he meets Dennis.
Who is this fuck?
A friend. He's from the neighborhood. We were just talking.
And Jeffrey is a voyeur and does not remain clean. He's certainly exploring his perversions, let's say. He's fascinated by this self-destructive chanteuse, this beautiful, voluptuous. And I think it's a mixture of both wanting to take care of as well as desecrate. He has the same impulses, and maybe thinking maybe by caring for her, she will be his, and somehow he'll be able to devour her, you know, at the same time being devoured by her.
Is that you, Jeffrey?
Yeah, it's me.
Jeffrey.
Sandy is the girl that gets Jeffrey involved with this whole thing in the first place. Mm. Sandy is also very interested in voyeurism. She listens to certain things. She gathers information. She's a detective.
My room is right above my father's office, so.
Above your father's office?
So I heard a few things about the year.
She's seemingly the all-American, lovable girl next door, the high school sweetheart. She's the light. She's, you know, the positive side. These were all the descriptions he gave me for the movie. And some of them are tangible and some of them are abstract, you know, in terms of the light and the dark and, you know, the seeming perfect world and the underbelly of it.
You know anything?
I don't know much but bits and pieces.
She inspires Jeffrey to go, you know, deeper into this mystery.
I can't believe what you're finding out. Are you gonna continue with this?
Yeah.
He wanted me to have a fascination with the dark side, with the mystery involved in the story, so that you have the taste of the darkness within the light side of the story.
And for the longest time, there was just this darkness. And all of a sudden, thousands of robins were set free, and they flew down and brought this blinding light of love. And it seemed like that love would be the only thing that would make any difference. And it did.
In that scene, I am the most hope-filled believer in that which is divine.
So I guess it means there is trouble till the robins come.
And really being confused, as is Jeffrey, in our lost innocence, that there are people like Frank. You know, why is there so much trouble in this world? Why are there people like Frank? I mean, that's the question we're all asking now, man. Why are there people like Frank?
Don't say please, fuckhead!
I think that when you commit to a work, you have to commit to the script, or you have to commit to the work. You can't commit always to improving your self-image, as a politician will improve their self-image to become more popular. My duty as a model was to portray glamour, and I tried to do that as best I could. When we did Blue Velvet, it was very important that maybe Dorothy Valance, the character, might have been glamorous, might have had glamour, but now she was broken. I mean, I've always imagined her as a broken doll, you know, one of these beautiful dolls that you put in the bed, you know, with the ruffles and the hair completely done, but something had happened, and you know, the hair are all done, the makeup is falling off, the dress are. That was the idea of a broken doll, you know, so the glamour still, some of it was there, and some of it was erased, some of it was being raped, broken violently. Hit me! Hit me! Hit me!
And I think that she's a great actress because she somehow understands the human condition. And no matter what kind of strange situations, she's able to find these things and portray them. And so, and you know, that's all you need. You've got to find them and make them real, and she can do it.
I knew in the case of Blue Velvet that it was important not only to be David's decision, but also to be my decision. And it was not very clear in the script how far he wanted to take this character. Was Dorothy only a sexy sex symbol? I wouldn't have wanted to play it like that. It would have been too embarrassing, basically, for me. But if there was this other shading of this desperation and complete helplessness and madness, and David liked it. He had always imagined her with hair like a country western singer, because she was singing. And we tried the wig, and because the wig looked wiggy, and we were afraid that people thought we didn't do a good wig, we then decided to do a scene where I just take it off. For me, it was perfect because it added to the fact that she was hiding. See, I wanted to hide behind my makeup, behind my clothing, behind my hair. Dorothy wanted to pretend everything was all right. She was in control because, in fact, she was completely devastated. So I made, you know, the makeup the most traditionally: black eyeliner, black eyelashes, blue, red lips, smile, perfect hair. You know, clothes perfect, almost like a facade that would hide the tempest and the torment that, and the fact that she couldn't make any sense. But she brings this facade like a little doll. Everything is fine. So I loved wearing the wig. It was part of the camouflage, her madness. The nudity was purposely not appealing because this was a woman who was abused, regularly raped, beaten. And what I had in mind, it was, you know, the butcher shop where you see these carcasses of cows cut in the middle and open? It was the sort of images that you have in Francis Bacon, you know, that you have these images of cows and flesh that do you think of human beings. And that's what I wanted to portray, but I think that was such a tradition in films of women nudity as a titillating nudity. It was more a Francis Bacon painting that I was trying to convey. I think the one scene that is most offensive, the nude scene that is most offensive, the one that I walk down the street completely naked, David Lynch has told me that when he was a little boy and was going home with his brother, they saw a naked lady walking in the streets, and they didn't feel titillating. They didn't say, oh, naked lady. They started to cry. They understood that something violent or frightening was happening. And he wanted to convey that idea, and that was David's direction. When David was talking about it, I had in mind the photo of Nick Ott, of the girl in Vietnam being burned by napalm. She's walking on the street naked, and in his gesture of helplessness, Dorothy at that moment had to be broken, had to hit bottom. And if I would come out covering myself, she still had a sense of self. She still had a sense of protecting herself or dignity. Anything that I would have done, I don't know, nothing else came to mind. I really didn't want to offend people. And I thought and thought and thought all, you know, a lot about what else I could do. But I think the power of that picture censor any other solution. So at the end, I decided just to come out like this, you know, toward Jeffrey, to just as the last desperate cry for help.
Don't you look at me, fuck!
I shoot when I see the whites of the eyes.
Frank deals, like with any kind of thing, with violence as a way to shock people into the reality that they better give him what he wants or they're going to lose something.
Here's to Ben.
Here's to Ben.
Be polite!
I'd used drugs and alcohol so long as an acting device that I was really sort of terrified of acting again. But I went back to basically Strasbourg, and it worked much better than anything I've been doing before.
Don't you fucking look at me.
There was no improvisation. I don't think there was any dialogue improvisation at all in my performance. There was a lot of physical things. I mean, things I did with my hands. I mean, this came from, like, you know, taking acid and seeing rings around your hands. Yeah, and various things that came out of my physical being, and the thing of using amyl nitrate as a sense memory.
What's Blue Velvet?
David had it as helium. And he had helium on the set. You know, helium doesn't disorient your mind at all, doesn't get you high. It just makes you sound like Donald Duck. Yeah, in a very high voice. So I tried to use it, and I was listening to my voice, and I just thought it was terrible. And I said, you know, I thought of this as amyl nitrate or nitric oxide, and David said, what's that? And I said, it's something that disorients your mind for a few minutes, and it's used generally sexually and so on for deviates.
Mommy.
And I thought, what a great contribution that was. And a couple years ago, I was sitting alone, I was thinking, what a great contribution that was. And then I suddenly thought, you know, how weird David Lynch really is. How strange it would have been if you would have just settled down and actually used that mask just to change your voice and not to do anything emotional or disorient your mind or anything. What a strange, sinister character that would have been. I thought of him as a rock star. I walked like a peacock, sort of, and sort of stood like, you know, I thought of Frank that way.
And then when we started filming together, he was just unrelenting. I didn't really have to do very much but just react to what he was doing.
You're from the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Your neighbor.
And he was funny. He was funny, and I remember thinking to myself, God, does he realize how funny he is?
Heineken! Fuck that shit! Pabst Blue Ribbon!
Should I laugh? Should I not laugh? Which David, I think, is so famous for, and which Dennis was capturing perfectly.
Where's the glasses? That beer's gonna get warm. One thing I can't fucking stand is warm beer. Makes me fucking puke.
I think heavies are good guys, you know? And I think that, like, you know, that everybody who's a heavy thinks they're a good guy, you know? So I start out with the premise that this is a love story. And that his love is so intense that he'll kidnap her husband, he'll cut off the husband's ear, he'll take the child, he'll do whatever he has to keep the love and the respect of this woman.
Frank is a person totally in love, but he doesn't know quite how to show in a normal way, but he knows all about love. He's desperately, you know, in love.
I didn't know what Dennis Hopper was going to do, and I was singing the scene, and then when it was time for the camera was on him, and I sang for him so he could react to me, I saw that he was crying, you remember, and I thought, oh, what a splendid actor he is, you know, to have made that leap, that in that moment he is in love with her and is crying, longing for her, wanting to be good or whatever. He was brokenhearted.
Thank you.
David's a painter. He paints with the camera, he paints with his pen, he paints with his hands. He's very much hands-on. I know the first time I saw David on the set, he was in Dorothy's apartment. And I walked in the door and came around. There's the camera and the camera crew and everybody was there. And I said, well, where's David? And they pointed over in the corner and there was David on his hands and knees, and he was placing these, what he called dust bunnies, under the wall radiator. Now, chances are the camera would never catch that, but in David's world, that made it more real.
He is constantly at work and constantly creating. A light breaks on a set, and he realizes he needs light, and he wants it coming from this area, so, oh God, they're gonna see that. Okay, so it needs to be a lamp. We don't have a lamp. We've got to shoot. I'll make a lamp. And next thing I know, man, he's literally, we were doing this one scene on Blue Velvet, and he wired a piece of wood and put like a shade on it that he found from somewhere else. And all of a sudden there was this like insane like lamp with like a piece of wood and antlers and some weird thing in the corner.
There are scenes that take place with logs in the background, and there's a lot of lumber around the place and wood and what have you. David was very careful in choosing background actors and wardrobe as to what they were going to look like. And so for extras and cameo speaking parts,
hey babe,
David interviewed and handpicked each one.
He had a very precise idea of how the set should look. And every person had a house that was very distinctive, definitely as an extension of who we were. And Dorothy had this dark, deep red walls, like a womb or a cave.
David, as a painter, you know, has these images in his head, and we were there, Patty Norris and I, we were there to kind of support that and to find the way to get that on film. For instance, the color of Dorothy's apartment was very particular, was very important. We knew we'd be there for a while. We needed that color to be particular, and we didn't want that color to be in other parts of the film. That was that space. So, you know, we chose carefully.
Why are you here?
It's great to be able to build a set like that, because you get to put everything where it belongs. You get to make these areas of the apartment where different things happen. And David was very specific because he had written the story. He knew that Dennis and Isabella, you know, are in this area here. There's kind of a very dark corner over here where Isabella goes and where Isabella takes, you know, Jeffrey's character over there. The kitchen is kind of bright, and that's off to the side. There's a bathroom down at the end of the hall. It's there, she's there, but you can't see what she's doing. I mean, the kind of slats that are in the closet door were very specific, and we made tests to see how the light came through and what looked best. Much of the film is dark and mysterious. There's this undertone to the dark part of the world. All the car rides, all those things are pretty shadowy.
Oh. Frank's here.
That scene is so incredible. We walked in and David had cast all these fat women, these obese women, sitting on the couch, and the strange, like, you know, this is David creating things that I don't need to know what I did before I came in the door. I just got to deal with being inside there.
Darling, could you bring some glasses? And we'll have a beer with Frank. Thank you.
I think Dean Stockwell is an amazing actor, and he's wonderful in that scene. And he put a cast on his arm, you know, as if his arm had been broken or whatever. And this is all stuff he just did in the makeup trailer. I don't know whether he'd talked to David about it. I'm not sure, but it worked good.
You know, David said, well, you know, there is this song.
A candy-colored clown they call the Sandman. Tiptoes to my room every night.
So David, you know, grabbed this work light, and he sort of, you know, was sort of showing me what he would do with the thing as a microphone.
I close my eyes, then I drift away.
And it just stuck. I mean, we just kept that as an image. It makes the scene just sort of transcend to some new level of strangeness.
In dreams, I walk
dad this found this giant warehouse building where we were filming, and David said, you know, it's this dark, very moody, it's the bad side of town, you know, there shouldn't be too much light, you know, just kind of keep it down a little bit. So I masterfully lit this giant warehouse, and David came by and looked at it and said, it's too bright, you know, there wouldn't be all this light out there in the factory, you know, it's like night, there's nothing happening here, you know, there's no people, and it has no sense of, you know, this mystery. And so I said, well, you know, what should we do? And he said, well, turn it off, you know, just turn, you turn it off, and this goes, it's very dark. But then we started to construct this machine to make this shadow. So we took sort of the one big light that we had, and then, you know, with cardboard cutouts and all sorts of things, made this factory shape to project on the side of the building. And David said, but there's nothing happening at the factory. There needs to be some movement. So one by one, you know, all the crew members were out there with various things, making big pistons, you know, go up in front of the light, and making levers, you know, go through here, and we would blow some smoke through the scene. So all of a sudden, you know, in a few minutes, we'd created this whole different feeling about the place. I had never done a film before that was widescreen, and it's great. It's just so beautiful. It's just the most beautiful shape to compose in. It gives you so many options because you can use it all. You can sort of lop off part of it and just use the little bit at the end. You can, you know, make it very narrow and just use a little sliver in the middle. You know, it's very good for people lying down on beds, you know, because they kind of fill the frame. It's good for two people sitting in a car because you can actually frame them, especially a big old American car. They fit better. It's a fun shape. It's a neat shape to use.
You know, the idea for Blue Velvet, though, came about from Bobby Vinton's song.
She wore blue velvet.
Blue Velvet?
Yes.
It's a song, and it's a texture.
Softer than satin was the light from the stars.
The producers did not want to pay for the Bobby Vinton record. David loved the authentic flavor of it, and they came to me and they said, if we can get Bobby Vinton now, could you do an arrangement that sounds like the original record? I said, yeah, I could make it sound like a 50s record by using some of those instruments, and I can certainly emulate that kind of orchestration, and we would have to get Bobby Vinton to sing it. So David acquiesced to this. He said, great, if we can get Bobby Vinton and we'll just do it over again, it would be great. The only trouble was that this is like 20 years after Bobby Vinton, you know, had this. So the first thing we had to do was drop the key like 2.5 steps. So you no longer had that little pure boy-like sound. And though the track was very authentic in the sound, and David loved the track, when we went into the studio and worked with Bobby, we both kind of looked at each other and said, you know, even though he did a nice job, this is not really going to be the authentic thing. And David went back and said, look, I have to have the original recording.
She wore blue.
When it was time to pre-record Isabella singing Blue Velvet, and we had the rights to the song, she couldn't do it. She's not a singer. She tried very hard. The piano player couldn't get it in the right key, and the drummer and the guitar player, it just didn't work at all. So I called a friend of mine, Angela Badalamenti, who's a composer from New Jersey, New York City, that I had worked with in the past. And I said, Angela, you got to do me a favor. I'm in trouble. Please come to Wilmington for a couple of days and help me with Isabella do Blue Velvet.
Isabella and I just sat alone and we worked on the song Blue Velvet, and we worked for maybe 3 hours or so, and we got a really very, very nice interpretation of her singing the song Blue Velvet, which is me playing piano and Isabella singing.
It didn't matter that Dorothy had a beautiful voice. It was more a dramatic interpretation that counted, and actually maybe the fact that she had a poor voice was addict to the fact that she wasn't much of a singer, that she didn't have a career that might have liberated her from that.
She wore blue velvet.
The tone of the song was Somewhere Over the Rainbow with Judy Garland, that sort of longing, and that was the tone that I adopted. And my name was Dorothy, so I thought maybe it also had to do with there was a sign, there was the right way to go.
Isabella, came in at David's behest to work with me and do the final track for the song Blue Velvet. And the night before, she had done that scene where it was raining on her, and I think she had that nude scene, she comes out of the bushes, and she was up till 3-4 in the morning, and rain all over, and she comes into the studio where I'm now prepared to do her vocal. I had the track already, which I did. And she says, Angelo, I can't sing. I had a rough night last night. I'm cold and I have a cold, my sinuses are bad and all of that. And I just can't do it. I was a little tender to Isabella. And Isabella, okay, let's just take it a step at a time. Let's get some hot tea with lemon. You like tea? Yep. Okay. Let's get a blanket and put it on you because you are cold and, you know, oh, but I'm not going to sing. Okay. And after a while with some tea and some talk, I said, I tell you what, let's just experiment with the microphone. Let's just do one or two lines, just the first phrase and see how it goes. And Isabella agreed to that. And we started out and we would do a phrase. And that really sounds nice. Let's do this phrase over, or let's punch this in. Before you know it, 2 or 3 hours later, we got just a beautiful recording, and it worked.
I think Angelo must have done the biggest editing job ever, where he took a sigh here, a word there, and put together my voice so I can hold the tune. At least I had to do something, because I just don't have a voice. But singing is like acting, you know, it's all about emotions.
Fred Caruso once said, Angelo, David wants to use this song of the Siren, in his film. He loves it. It's his favorite record and vocal of all time. But Dino said, you know, this is going to cost so much money. Can't you write something like that? And I said, well, you know, first of all, I'm not a lyricist, so I would need a lyric. So I just said to Fred, I said, Fred, have David, who's also lived with this movie and knows what he wants to say in a lyric, write some lyrics. So David, as I found out, reluctantly agreed to do this, and he writes a lyric called Mysteries of Love. Isabella comes into New York, and I am working with Isabella and recording her, and she brings me this little yellow piece of paper, and on it, it says Mysteries of Love. And I'm looking at the lyric, and I'm saying, it's like, you know, sometimes a wind blows and you and I float in love and kiss forever in a darkness. And it just had this kind of spaciness, and I'm saying, my goodness, this is not a lyric that I'm used to. This is just, you know, a bit of poetry. It's not really a song. So I was a bit disappointed, to be perfectly honest with you, in the lyric. And David said, oh, just make it, you know, float through time. Make it like the wind. Make it like the sea. Make it endless. Make it cosmic. I said, oh, I see. I wrote a melody to his lyric. David heard it, fell in love with it. And then he said, now we got to get a singer that sings like an angel. Then Julie Cruz came into the picture, who was a friend of mine. She was a singer that worked in a show that I had written, actually a workshop downtown Manhattan. And Julie sang like an angel, and then David heard that, fell in love. So that was our start of our relationship.
Alan Splett was the sound designer on Blue Velvet, and he definitely is or was a sound designer. He designed sound that made that world come alive. He gave a signature to that sound, and it had a meaning.
Most of the time, it's the pictures first, and the pictures dictate what kind of sounds we're looking for. And, you know, they, when added to the picture, become extremely magical.
Fun working with industrial environments, though, because you can you have a lot of leeway in what you can do with the sounds.
Now, Alan Splett and David go way back, way before I met them. They had done little films together, and Alan was certainly involved with the conception of Eraserhead. He was a genius in finding, creating sounds, and he would do anything to get the sound. I mean, he was out there, he was recording bits and pieces every day. He created this whole undercurrent to the film, and if you listen to it carefully, you hear it change gears.
Of, you know, filmmaking is the first times you hear, you know, all the sounds and the music together. And sometimes, even before we get down, you know, to subtle kind of levels, we just open up all the pots and just let everything run, and it's take you to another place. It's fantastic.
I did go to a screening, the first screening that David had for Dino De Laurentiis. And the lights went up, and everybody looked at each other. And somebody said, "So what are you gonna do with this movie, Dino?" And Dino said, "David, I have to start my own distribution company in order to release this picture, because I don't know anyone who wants to buy this picture."
And we didn't even really know what we had when we finished Blue Velvet. No one knew. It was, you know, we were just making this interesting kind of little movie and no expectation at all.
And the movie came out and became Blue Velvet.
From the mind of David Lynch comes a modern day masterpiece, so startling, so provocative, so mysterious, that it will open your eyes to a world you have never seen before.
The public reaction to the initial release of Blue Velvet, I think on the whole, was rather negative.
And the film was not well received and just languished for a while until Pauline Kael, I think, the story goes, picked up the standard and said, you know, this is really a good film, we should take a second look, and people began to sort of look at it again. I think it just sort of rode a wave of, you know, this is a great film, everyone should see it, you know, at some point in time in your life.
When they love the film, they praise David Lynch as a great director. When they didn't like the film, they just try to figure out why they didn't like it. And they always seemed to me that they would pick on me.
It's not how Isabella Rossellini reacts to the fact that she's standing there nude and humiliated on the lawn of the police captain's house with lots of people watching. It's how I react. Mm-hmm. And that's painful to me to see a woman treated like that. And I want to know that if I'm feeling that pain, it's for a reason that the movie has other than simply to cause pain to her.
I really thought it was my fault because I really thought David was had proven himself as a director in other films. And so maybe he should have had Helen Mirren, who was his first choice for the role, and there wouldn't have been any doubts. But I came with the baggage from my family or from my modeling career, and maybe also inexperience, because it was my second American film and my third film in my career. And so that maybe there was a lack of experience that, and I couldn't convey clearly this idea. So for a long time, I suffered because I attribute it to my lack on my inability as an actress. And also I thought I damaged David, and I was really sorry for that because I really thought he was a great artist, you know, and if he could just have his actress, he didn't have to deal with my background and my images and my ghosts, and his film would have been more appreciated.
This did for me what Psycho did as a lot younger, which is eyes open and, oh my God, we're really getting in over our heads. And that's an experience which is challenging, shocking, but mesmerizing, and I like the picture.
Reviewers then kept talking about it and writing about it, and you had to go see the movie again, and you had to see the movie again.
You know, you either love it and think it's the most brilliant thing around, or you have the opposite reaction and you hate it, but there are honest feelings associated with that that make you think that way. And I think that Blue Velvet was something that it took a while for it to find its audience.
Whether they liked the movie or were disturbed by the movie or couldn't sit with it, they appreciated that someone was daring to truly be a filmmaker.
I had won 2 Golden Globe nominations out of 5. I had 1 for Hoosiers and 1 for Blue Velvet, and the national critics had given me for both. But I thought if I was going to win a nomination, Academy Award nomination, it would be for Blue Velvet, not for Hoosiers. But it shows the makeup of the Academy.
It works on so many levels, and unexpectedly, I think, which I think the best films sort of do. They sort of surprise you.
Get back and stay down.
It started not having a very good reputation, and it ended up having a better reputation. But it's still hard for me to define, because there are still some people that are very offended by the film, and others think the film is great. Others think the film is comical. Others think the film is very scary. So people react to it differently.
You certainly feel like you've been through something, you know, and probably thankful that it was somebody you were watching on screen, not yourself.
We look on Blue Velvet now as being a movie that really affected people deeply. And upon subsequent viewings over time, you come back in touch with those feelings. And I think that's the mark of a good movie. It'll stand the test of time that way.
You're never through discovering things. And I personally love films that create a mood, but can be seen, you know, more than one time, and it's always a bit of a discovery again and again.